Welcome to Korea and the World, a podcast on political, economic, and social issues from the perspective of the Korean Peninsula.
This year will mark the 60th anniversary of the end of the Second World War. Yet, whereas European countries have learned to live and thrive with each other, this seems far from being the case for Korea and its former colonial master, Japan. Historical disputes are commonplace, and the relation between the two states seems to deteriorate year after year. Why do these historical disputes exist between Japan and Korea? Under which conditions did they develop, and why have they not been resolved since the end of the Second World War? In order to answer these questions, we had the privilege of speaking with Professor Kan Kimura. Professor Kimura obtained his bachelor's, master's, and PhD in law from Kyoto University, writing his doctoral dissertation on South Korean nationalism. A professor at Kobe University's Graduate School of Cooperation Studies since 1997, he was also a visiting scholar at various institutions, including Korea University, the Australian National University, and Harvard. Professor Kimura was also a member of the first and second Japan-Korea Collaborative History Research Committees, initially set up by Japanese Prime Minister Junichiro Koizumi and Korean President Kim Dae-jung to promote, quote-unquote, mutual understanding concerning accurate facts and recognition of history. Professor Kimura, welcome to Korea and the World.
Thank you.
Can you tell us about your background and why you chose to study South Korea?
My background is a little bit different from the other scholars, especially other scholars of the Japanese, because most of the scholars who have studied on South Korea, simply because they like Korean things, Korean foods, or Korean friends, or Korean history, something like that. But, you know, I was born in 1966, and I made a backpacker travel around the world, especially in the poor Asian countries. So I originally wanted to study something about the Southeast Asian country or South Asian countries or even Muslim countries. But when I talked with my supervisor, this is the story of the 1988, yes. My professor told me about the difficulties of the studies of the developing countries. So, you know, I thought about which area is the best choice for me to have an academic tenure post, to have to write down what kind of the advantages I can get as a Japanese scholar. And, you know, it was just this other story in 1980s. And as you see very well, the South Korea in the process of the democratization movement, the economy was very successful. And of course, you know, Korean language is very similar with Japanese. Mm. And the language of the colonial rule is Japanese itself. And Western scholars, you know, didn't have so deep studies in about South Korean politics. So I pick up South Korea as a good case studies on how the democratization movement, you know, work, or how the society reads and was changing in the process of the economic development.
We are students at Seoul National University, and we very often see Koreans and Japanese students interact on a daily basis, and I would say there is absolutely no problem there. The same is true when it comes to business relations between Korea and Japan. So why is there a dispute? Is there even a dispute between South Korea and Japan? Or is it merely an issue that happens at the elite level and in the media and has actually nothing to do with real life?
The baseline of the dispute have to be found on the experience of between Japan and Korea before 1945. But it doesn't mean that, you know, we have had a similar kind of disputes always since 1945. If you have a chance to have a cross-check about, you know, what kind of these things we have discussed between Japan, South Korea, you know, we can find a big change in the end of 1980s or the beginning of 1990s. For example, the issues like the conflict women was never discussed as important issues, political issues between Japan and South Korea since the beginning of 1990s. And the textbooks is also was not an issue before 1982.
Why was it not an issue beforehand?
In 1950s, the Japanese government and South Korean government had a long argument about how to establish and how the Japanese made compensation to South Korea. But at the time, they didn't, you know, pay attention to the details because the age was, you know, at the time, these most of the society, especially South Korean society, was dominated by the elite. Not just a political elite, but a very small number of elite. So that kind of the view of the political elite was different from the understanding of the common people. So in the treaty in 1965, with which Japan and South Korea established official diplomatic relations, South Korean government just asked the Japanese government to pay the money to South Korean government, not mm-hmm. each people, not each people, because they have elite, they are elite. And they had understanding that elite should distribute money to the people. You know, unfortunately, they understood that the kind of distributing the money is not so less important than the economic development. So they used most of them for the economic development. So this kind of situation has changed since the 1980s. In my understanding, with two reasons. First one is generation change. First one is generation change. Until 1970s, Japanese and South Korean elite and people didn't pay so much attention to the details simply because they knew that. So on newspaper, they didn't need to write down the details of the experience of the colonial rule as a news because it is not the news for them. But after 1980s, there was a big generation change in especially in South Korea. As you see, in 1979, President Park Chung-hee was assassinated. President Chung Do-hwan was just born in 1935. So they didn't know the detailed experience at the time of colonial rule. This kind of the big generation change, they started through the process of rediscoveries of the histories of the past. And so the Japanese textbooks issues and the government issue are the two very typical cases. You know, today, after 1982, South Korea started to criticize the Japanese textbook with saying the contents of the Japanese textbooks are different from South Korean one. But imagine the situation. What kind of understanding did Park Chung-hee had on Japanese textbooks? Park Chung-hee was educated by Japanese textbook itself. So it is nonsense for Park Chung-hee to imagine the Japanese textbook has the same content with South Korean. But people, especially the normal people, in 1980s or 1990s, because simply they didn't know that kind of things. So first the media started to report the content of the Japanese textbooks in 1980s. They were shocked very much, simply because they didn't know the content at all. And also the Kon-homa Demishi also said, in the beginning of the 1990s, one of the most important projects for the movement to save the Kon-homa women was simply to find Kon-homa women's victims themselves. It means that in the beginning of the 1990s, they didn't know who was Kon-homa women in their society. That kind of situation cannot be imagined in 1970s. Mm-hmm. Everybody knew who were Kon-homa women. Although, of course, they didn't say anything about the kind of secret story, but they knew that. But in 1990s, the professors, students, especially younger students, started to find the new things, the new aspect of the history, simply because they are not taught.
Professor Kimura, you mentioned the textbook controversy, the comfort women. What other main issues are keeping South Korea and Japan apart?
First, the basic situation is the same. With other the issues like textbooks and the women's. In case of the Dr. Takeshima issues, although we continuously have had a low level of the argument since 1945, because it is related to the territory, very important issues. But until 1980s, the level of the argument was very low because the political elite could control the level. So every time they found some kind of the serious dispute, they made the best efforts not to make the dispute so seriously. The same kind of things also can be said on the ASCII issues. The typical case is the case of the Prime Minister Nakasone's visit to Yasukuni in 1985. Just after the visit of the Yasukuni of the Nakasone, of course the South Korean government, Christine and South Korea made a lot of articles, but you know, the situation stopped very soon, just in 1 or 2 weeks. Because they found that Japanese and the South Korean relation is very important. So they understood that they shouldn't have a very serious situation between Japan and South Korea. So the point is, you know, until the 1980s, we had some disputes. But that kind of dispute haven't, you know, damaged the official or economical and social relationship between Japan and South Korea almost at all. Just a dispute.
How do you explain that the South Korean elite, according to you, was always trying, you know, to go forward and maybe push these issues aside, but at the same time, it seems the Korean population at large wants some kind of apology or something? Why is there a discrepancy between the elite and the rest of the population in Korea?
Until 1980s, Japan was a huge country. 40% of the share of the all of the South Korean trade was occupied by Japan with that over by the trade with Japanese. In that kind of situations, you know, South Korea elite, not just political elite and also business elite, had to pay attention to, had to worry about damage once the situation was, the relation was damaged. This is very serious. So the political elite and business elite, you know, had to make the best, you know, efforts. Of course, the business elite and the political elite had a very, you know, big influence on the media. So with using the kind of pressure, you know, they could control the public opinion at the time. Of course, the normal people in South Korea might have the frustrations, but they had no chance to open their opinions publicly.
So if I understand well, because of the relative decline of Japan, the relative weakening of Japan, then it makes more sense to attack Japan because there are no lesser risks of repercussion.
Yes, and democratization of South Korea.
And democratization.
Yes, yes.
Let's talk about your experience in the Korea-Japan Collaborative History Research Committee that was set up by the two presidents of the time, Junichiro Koizumi and Kim Dae-jung. Mm-hmm. Can you maybe tell us about your experience? What was the committee doing and what was your role there?
The first thing I want to say is it is terrible expense for me. Of course, you know, the common understanding of the history is important, but the way of the studies of the history is themselves different from between Japan and South Korea. As you may know that Japanese scholars like to say something about the very details of the histories, right? But the South Korean scholars want to have more colors on the histories, you know, the historical understandings or perceptions or historical story, right? So, for example, in the South Korean textbook, they have a very strong story of their nationalism, right? But in Japan, we, Japanese academia, we didn't have that kind of understanding. So in the process, you know, Japanese scholars made a presentation about the detail, and the South Korean scholar was frustrated about the, you know, the presentations, and starting to say, what do you want to say, or something like that. Because we are selected by the, you know, each government, especially on the very severe issues like Takeshima Docto, it was very hard for some scholars to say something against the official understanding of each government. So, you know, as a result, each side of the scholar just repeats the official understanding or non-matching argument, you know, again and again.
So you found
I was exhausted. You know, some scholars, South Korean, you know, scholars started to be upset about, against the, some of the Japanese scholars and started to say, I cannot meet them, or something like that. So I flew to Seoul to make a kind of diplomatic negotiation with South Korea side. You know, what kind of apologies we should made, or something like that. That's nonsense. Mm-hmm. Because that, the past is important. But in a dispute, you know, the past we are discussing between Japan and South Korea are the past before 1945. But the disputes are happening after 1945, or today. So without understanding today's situations, we cannot understand, you know, why we are having the kind, this kind of dispute. So there was a very clear limitations of the world, of the job of the historians. So in that meaning that the joint research committees of the historian have to be unsuccessful from the beginning, I believe.
Where do we stand now, 10 years after these committees you participated in? Would you say the situation got worse?
Got worse, yeah, no doubt, no doubt. Because this project started in 2002, the first one was finished in 2005, and the second one started in 2007 and ended in 2010. Just after the first project, we had a very serious disputes about the Takeshima Docto between the Koizumi government and Nohyon government. It means that, you know, the first project never could be a help to improve the situations. And the second project was a little bit smoother than the first one, because the South Korean, the Imhyeonpa government was a more cooperative. But in the meaning that Nomhyun government has a more, you know, harder line against Japanese. So even in the kind of situations in 2010, not between Japan and South Korea, but between Japan and China, we started the Senkaku disputes. And the situation of the Japanese public opinion against China and South Korea were getting worse and worse. So in the meaning that, you know, okay, we played some kind of role to give the excuse to the both government, but we couldn't make any important impact or influence on the both public opinions.
There seems also to be the issue of personalities between, you know, South Korea and Japan. Especially, it seems that Prime Minister Shinzo Abe attracts a lot of negative sentiment in South Korea. I think according to some opinion polls, he's even more unpopular than Kim Jong-un himself.
Right.
So what is the role that specific personalities play in this context? And do you think that Korean-Japanese relations would look very different if we had a very different, you know, cast of decision makers?
But, you know, to understand the questions about the South Korean, the understanding of the Prime Minister Abe, you have to understand that this is the second Abe government. The first Abe government was established in 2006. And if you have a chance to, you know, read the newspaper at the time of the establishment of Abe government, it is very easy for you to find that the South Korean media were welcoming the establishment of Abe government, saying that Abe likes something like Korean foods or something like that. You know, actually, in 2006, you know, I was happening in Seoul. I made a journalist meeting, you know, on the one of the South Korean newspaper to appeal how Abe is a good person for South Korea with the Seoul National University professors and other people. But, you know, if we check the understanding or ideologies of the Abe, Shinzo himself, Abe is always against the Kono statement about community issues, since 1990s. Mm-hmm. And yes, you know, he is always against the Murayama statement. Abe is always revisionist, you know. But in 2006, South Korean media and the South Korean government accepted Mr. Abe. 2013, at the time of the establishment of the second government and the Park Geun-hye government, you know, South Korean media had a very strong anti-Abe campaign against Japan. So, of course, Abe himself is important. And of course, the Abe's ideology or political understanding might not be good to improve the relationship between Japan and South Korea. But at the same time, we have to pay attention to the changing of the South Korean society. So in 2006, Abe's character was not a problem in South Korea. But today, it became a problem.
How do you explain that actually Shinzo Abe never changed in terms of his views, but somehow the Korean media accepted him in 2006? but now are against him?
I think international situations. Because that in 2006 that the Abe sent the message to the South Korean government. Imagine the situation. The president at the time was Nomuhyon, right? Very progressive person. So even the Nomuhyon could have a smoother relationship with very conservative Abe. But today, conservative Park Geun-hye cannot have any smooth relation with the conservative Abe. Very ironic. One of the reasons is that the message the Abe government, the first Abe government sent to South Korean government in 2006 was Japan and South Korea is sharing the same kind of the Western values. So we can make a cooperation or something like that. But the same kind of the message in 2013 was rejected by South Korean government. Simply because if Japanese side said, we are having the same value, Western value, so make a cooperation, it may mean fight against China together. So in nine or seven years, in South Korean society, the existence of China had become much bigger. So there was a situation that they have to pay more attention to the Chinese side. And of course, comparing with the importance of the China and the Japan, so if Japan sent the same message that was similar with 2006, there was a situation they had to reject. So Abe's message. It means that in 2006, this is conservative message, right? Conservative message was welcome. Could be welcome. But in 2013, it was understood very political in the situation. So the image of the Abe himself have to be changed in South Korean society. If you see the detail of the policy of the first and second Abe government, of course, the first government has a of the first Abe government has more positive stance against South Korea. But if we looked back the beginning of 2013, Abe also tried to approach to Park Geun-hye. But in the beginning, Nomuhyon said yes to Abe, and Park Geun-hye said no to Abe about the same kind of message. I am not in the position to defend Abe, but from the academic point of view, I think that the changing of the South Korean society looks to be the more important independent variable to understand today's situation.
You mentioned the South Korean society. What about the Japanese population? Do you think that they are also becoming more revisionist and thus allowing Mr. Abe to profess his own revisionism that you just mentioned?
Yes. In Japanese society, of course, in 2006, of course, we have a wave of the revisionists, but it was not so strong. It was not mainstream. But in 2013, the ideology like Prime Minister Abe has seemed to become a kind of the mainstream understanding of the history or the understanding of the international relations. So, there was a change between the first and the second Abe government. The big change is not on his ideology, but on his confidence and support. Because now Abe is in the situation he feel he could have enough support. Voting rate is very high, and many people supported the Abe's understanding. So now he can make his idea to real politics. But in 2006, Abe was a revisionist. But Abe, it might be difficult for us to say that all of the Abe government member were revisionists. So such kind of changing also can be found in in Japan. So both societies changed. Both societies changed. So behavior of the South Korean politicians and the behavior of Abe himself has changed. So situation is getting worse and worse.
Why has there never been a Japanese politician that really boldly pushes for an agenda of reconciliation, just like Willy Brandt did, in Germany? Why has there never been a Japanese prime minister, you know, falling on his knees just like Willy Brandt did in Warsaw and asking for forgiveness?
First, I have to say is that, you know, of course, you know, Japanese, you know, the prime ministers made some kind of the apologies, you know, repeatedly from the, at least from the 1980s, like Prime Minister Kaifu or Prime Minister Miyazawa and Prime Minister Murayama made a kind of apologies, including the Murayama statement. And even Hashimoto, Prime Minister Hashimoto was a very conservative person, but for example, you know, the, if you have a chance to read a letter which was sent from the Asian Women Fund to the victim of the Congo Agreement, you know, Hashimoto wrote a very sincere letter, the sincere apologies to the Congo Agreement victims. But if compared with such kind of the behaviors of the Japanese political leaders, of course, there were some difference, you know, from the German one. The baseline is that, you know, the most important thing is that, you know, the existence of the treaties of in 1965. Japanese government understand that all of the past issues were solved, have been solved by the treaty. So, okay, so they made apologies sometimes. But after the apologies, because they understand that they had no legal reason to pay something for the victims, I mean, actually, they bureaucratically especially, they cannot do that. Because Japanese Supreme Court also made the decision that the all of the issues had been set up by the treaties. If the government tried to send to pay the additional money to the South Korean victims or Chinese victims, normal Japanese people may start to send the issue to the court. You know, like saying that the Japanese politician had damaged the Japanese budget with spending money to the victims. So in the kind of situation, I can understand the situation of the South Korea. So however, you know, how many times we made a kind of the something like apologies, after that such kind of regrets, there were no reactions for the compensation from Japanese government. So they had to understand that, oh, Japanese apologies is just a theoretical things, no contents. They are just saying in Japanese tatemae, and the Japanese honne, you know, their real understanding might be different. So the apologize is not real apologize, they understood. So the most important key must be found on the how to understand the Japan-South Korean Treaty in 1965. And this situation was, and also most the other important point is the understanding is not just a political one, but also they were locked by the decisions of the both nations' Supreme Court.
Here in Korea, we usually get, you know, the victim side. Right? That's what we hear in Korea. But on the other side, it seems that in Japan, there is now more and more this so-called Korea fatigue. Can you explain what Korea fatigue is?
Yes, because first, you know, you should know that we are having that kind of, you know, as I said, that the common issues or textbook issues or yasukunis, that kind of issue have been discussed for 30 years already. So it was a new news. 1996, it was fresh. So the, you know, these Japanese side also had the understanding they had to do something. But this is just Japanese government understanding. But after that, you know, that we made a call of statement, and we established the Asian Women's Front and the Murayama statement. But, you know, the situation has not changed at all. And the other one is that, you know, especially for the Japanese elite, political elite and diplomatic elite, you know, they had this kind of an understanding. Okay? For example, in 1991, Notteu government at the time have the understanding that even the conformity women issue, you know, was included in the agreement of the Japan-South Korean Treaty in 1965. But suddenly in 1992, they changed the stance. Then in 1993, new President Kim Il-sung said he will not ask any compensation from Japanese government about comedy image. He declared. This is a story in March 1993. So Japanese side made a kind of statement, called a statement. But in 1996, changed his stance and started to ask the compensations, maybe because of the pressures, not the, from the big teams or the some kind of the groups who are assisting the combatant victims. So in Japanese side, because we had that kind of experience, like South Koreans, we had a feeling that we are already betrayed by the South Korean government. South Korean government. So they, the today's people, they said that they sometimes said that, oh, whatever the agreement we made between Japan and South Korea, in near future, they will start to say something different. Something says this is no end. So in Japanese, you know, public opinion, we are already tired about the talk with the South Korean side. You know, that, you know, the, comparing with the Chinese side, you know, Chinese is very political, so you know, country, so we can make a political negotiations. But in South Korea, you know, we cannot have even positive political, you know, the negotiation. That this kind of the understanding today's political elites and diplomatic elites and the media are having on the South Korean society and government.
A few days ago, American Undersecretary of State Wendy Sherman expressed her perception that these disputes are used by politicians to garner domestic support. Do you think this is a fair assessment of this back and forth between Japan and Korea? And are those position changes motivated by, you know, the prospect of, well, domestic gains, electoral gains?
For me, that the half statement, you know, doesn't look so strange at least. Of course, the South Korean side has some kind of, say, quote unquote justice, you know, against Japanese side. But if, you know, we pay attention to the dispute, diplomatic relations, it is very strange for us to see that the one country rejects the, you know, top level meeting with the counterpart. Because one problem is not solved. Because that, you know, the issue can be solved by the summit meeting. If we have the kind of the summit meeting, so in that meaning that, you know, it is, you know, natural for the American government to ask the both or three countries to make more positive efforts, improve the relations. In the meaning that you know, in South Korea, the half statement seemed to have been understood as that the Americans criticized South Korean historical understanding. But this statement shouldn't be understood so. Against Japanese side, she or American government may be asking the more efforts to improve the situation with a more positive understanding against to the China and South Korean side. But for South Korean side, there must be something different, but something they can do to improve the situation. They should open the door to hold the negotiations. And if they don't have if they don't open the door for the negotiation, this situation or have been already continued for 3 years, almost. During these 3 years, of course, you know, not just on the fiscal dispute, but exchanges of the two countries are stopping, especially military corporations or economic cooperation or FTA negotiation or something like that. Of course, this is nonsense. This is nonsense, and the whole United States, of course, this kind of situation cannot be an interest for the American government. So it is very natural for the American government to open the frustrations against this kind of situation.
But didn't the U.S. play a role in creating these historical disputes as we know them today, when they decided to go on the so-called reverse course, when they decided to stop the prosecution of Japanese war criminals, you know, in favor of economic reforms and balancing against the Soviet Union, you know, somehow it didn't allow Japan to go through the same process maybe Germany had. And, you know, it allowed for imperialism and these issues to maybe remain unchecked. And now they're coming back and saying to the Koreans and the Japanese to forget about the past because now it's time to balance against China. Isn't it kind of the same?
But the situation in 1960s and 1970s and today's are very different, you know. This is the point. Because that in 1960s and 70s, Japan is almost only one junior partner of the United States in Asia. And compared with that kind of big Japan, South Korea was almost nothing at the time. So actually the Nixon government or Carter government once tried to withdraw all of the American troops from South Korea, right? So they might have wanted to give up South Korea itself. South Korea was just such kind of, you know, existence for the United States until 1970s. So, you know, such kind of American existence was very important things for Japanese to have a very strong pressure against South Korea's politics with the backing up of the Americans. But in today's situation, of course, you know, the Japan is still the most important junior partner in North Asia for the United States. But of course, the South Korean existence is bigger and bigger. And at least they are the one of the members of G20. Of course, the American never can ignore the statement or understanding of South Korean things. So they need to make a balance. So the basis of the today's situations might have been made by the existence of the Americans. But today's situation itself cannot be explained directly by the existence of Americans. But if there is one big element which escalated or is escalating the situation between Japan and South Korea with the existence of the United States is a military thing. You know, ironically, you know, in Japan, normally, not just the political elite, but even normal people understand that China and the US is a rival. You know, it's competing each other in Asia. But South Korean people said, no. Of course, they have some competence. But, you know, in the globalizing world. Anyway, lastly, China and the US will make a cooperation, they said. Then, there's a reason why we had a, you know, totally different understanding about the relationship between China and the United States. Because the military role, which was expected by the United States, are different to the Japan and South Korea. But because Japan had a big naval force, and the U.S. bases in Japan, the biggest one is the naval base in Yokosuka. And in the rivalry between the China and the U.S. on the sea, Japanese military power have a role, can do something to assist the U.S. forces. But unfortunately, South Korean's military power is mainly on land, right? And American bases in South Korean Peninsula is Air Force and, you know, Army. So that kind of, you know, the characteristic of the U.S. military power in Korea and Korean military cannot be directly used for the competence between China and the U.S. As a result, you know, U.S. messages to each country have to be understood differently. You know, for Japanese, you know, it seemed that, oh, America is very positive to challenge against China because we are expecting some roles there. But whole South Korea, simply because America don't expect any positive role militarily, it is natural for South Korean people to understand, oh, America has a more, you know, the don't take any tougher stance against China. Just on this point, American existence is playing a role to divide the two countries' understanding on the international situations.
One of the recommendations you make in your writings is that Koreans and Japanese have to give less attention to these issues, especially so since, you know, the perceptions are so different. Why do you think that could be a solution? What has to change for that to happen, to let go?
Of course, the issues on the dispute itself is important, but at the same time, there are other important issues between Japan and South Korea. Political, economical, and something about society, of course. But if we too much pay attention to the, you know, historical disputes, both countries' public sphere became very nationalistic. And that kind of situation make us not to have the objective, cool argument in our society. The importance of the issue and the escalation of the dispute is different. It's two things, totally different. Mm. So we need to have, you know, the ideas how to control the escalation of the disputes. The worst case is that you know, these politicians or journalism use this kind of issue for their business. Of course, you know, for that kind of thing behaviors, we should have criticize very strongly. At least we have to ask them, by saying such kind of things, what kind of things we can actually get? What is the national interest? What kind of national interest can be achieved by picking up, you know, by picking up such kind of issues? That kind of strategical ideas must be heard, at least for politicians and elites, I think.
De-escalation in the name of national interest makes obviously sense from an outsider's perspective, from probably a Japanese perspective, but isn't it saying to the victims, most of them Koreans, that, you know, their suffering doesn't matter as much nowadays as the economy or as security issues, and, well, should be, you know, brushed aside?
About the two countries' relations, there are a lot of dimensions. You know, in Japan and in South Korea, you know, there are a lot of people, you know, who have a very, very strong criticism against the counterpart. For example, if we really want to start a positive negotiation between two countries, we need to have a logic to explain the importance to find the solutions of the such issue like counter-human. One of the techniques is to explain the importance of the relationship between Japan and South Korea itself. Because we have the relationship with South Korea, it's very important. So to the people who criticize the South Korean understanding on commitment, so we have to hear the opinion of the source of South Korean side. And to keep that kind of good relations, we also need to have to make efforts to find a solution for the competition. This kind of setting up is very important. So in that meaning that if we just see the issue itself, the issue will be very nationalistic and ideological. But if we argue this issue with the importance of the Japan-South Korean relations, okay, this is just actually in diplomatic negotiations, okay? If one side, you know, not surrender, but one side, you know, give up some part of their opinions, they need to have the reasons, at least politically. So in that meaning that this kind of, you know, setting up is very important. So not just, you know, picking up the historical issue is not a good idea.
In conclusion, Professor Kimura, as we mentioned before, we see Japanese and Korean students interacting with each other every day. Do you think the young generation has a different mindset than those in power right now? And do you think these issues may, well, die together with this old post-war generation? Especially as a professor, you know, you also obviously talk about these issues with your Japanese students. What do you feel is the atmosphere?
I always say that somebody is interested in about this dispute and they want to see the more positive situation between Japan and South Korea, you know, we cannot solve that kind of situation just by simple exchanges. Between Japan and South Korea, in last year, there are 5 million people traveled between the two countries. And the number of the flights between Japan and South Korea is the world's third or second biggest after US-Canada travel flights. You know? So it is nonsense for us to expect that there are more cooperation, because more exchanges will help the situation dramatically, because the exchange is big enough. But the reason why that kind of, you know, the exchanges cannot play the positive role in between two countries, because, you know, in the globalized world, the exchanges with other countries is growing more rapidly. So we have to change our idea, and we have to have some new ideas. Okay, if today's younger generation just continue the same effort of my generation, I say that's nonsense. We have seen that how we failed. But if the new generation can have new ideas, including the idea of the solution of the each issues, or better setting up to understand the both government historical perceptions. For example, in South Korea, you know, many people mentioned about Kono statement, but I don't think that, you know, the 90% of the South Korean people never read the Kono statement, right? And many people complained about the Japanese textbooks, but they didn't know that we had, even for the senior high school level, 16 textbooks. Of course, there was no person who have read all of the textbooks, right? So, because they had no chance. They had no chance. Anyway, if the new generation find new ideas, more concrete ideas, to improve the Japanese-South Korean relation, okay, they can do that. But I hope the younger generation not to be satisfied with today's activities, you know, start and try to have the what kind of new movements can be made for both countries. This is my understanding.
Professor Kimura, thank you so much for your time and for being our guest today.
Thank you.
This was Korea and the World. To make sure you don't miss our next episode, bookmark our website, koreaandtheworld.org, subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, and follow us on Facebook and Twitter.